pledge that the winner will allow the loser all the proper funeral rituals.
There are no pacts between the lions and men.
Of us.
Was that husband?
That's Andromache, the wife. There's no mother in it. They didn't even bother to cast Hecuba.
In 1993, Robert Drews wrote this book here, in which he argued that the collapse of the Bronze Age kingdoms happened as a result of changes in the way that warfare was conducted. It was the first book that I ever read on the subject, and it's a fairly good overview of all the theories that were bouncing around at the time. It's not perfect. I mean, it was written nearly 30 years ago, and a lot of it is now, as a result, dated. For example, Drews is fairly dismissive of environmental factors and climate change, because to be fair, in his day, they didn't know that much about what was going on with the climate 3,000 years ago. All of that is recent research. Despite all this, Drews' explanation still holds up, and even though it might not be the whole story, it's a large enough part of it that makes it worth exploring in a bit more detail. His basic theory is this. In the 17th century BCE, chariot and bow technology had come far enough that the chariot archer became king of the battlefield at the time. And this meant that the great states that could afford the bureaucracies and had the wealth to maintain large chariot armies started to dominate those that didn't. This then carried on all the way to the 13th century, at which point the Near East went through a period of prolonged peace. But then, after a generation or two of peace, conflicts begin to arise again with Sea Peoples, Philistines, Libyans, take your pick. And at this point, new technologies like greaves, swords, and javelins had made the infantryman the master of the battlefield, not the charioteer. And because these large kingdoms had basically built their whole society around a chariot elite, because the chariot had been king of the battlefield for so long, they couldn't change fast enough to adapt to this new world, and as a result, were overrun. Drews was not the first to suggest this theory. In fact, ever since the Sea Peoples became a popular subject of historical study, experts have been grappling with the idea of, did they have some military technology that the Bronze Age states didn't, which gave them some kind of advantage. And there is one huge change in technology in this period of time, which many people once thought had changed everything: the adoption of iron. There was no iron in the Bronze Age. Well, sort of. There were bits and bobs of iron, but the majority of things were still made out of bronze. But do you know what historians call the period directly after the Bronze Age collapse? The Iron Age, because surprise, surprise, they started using iron. Iron is better than bronze in basically every way. It's better at rusting, it's better at having a higher melting temperature, and it's better for making weapons. In 1942, the historian Gordon Child came up with an idea that would make an excellent book or TV series, but sadly probably didn't actually happen. He suggested that the Hittites had foreseen the importance of iron in the future and had begun secretly experimenting with it deep in the heart of the Anatolian mountains. But soon the subject peoples that worked the iron realized that they were the real masters of this new tool and that they had nothing to lose but their chains. So they seized the means of production, used that means of production to make iron weapons with which they overran their Hittite overlords, and then they went on to become and or join the Sea Peoples that we know and love. This was an immensely influential work, and soon ironworking hypotheses were popping up everywhere. The story changed, you know, from theory to theory, but the core argument was always the same. The powers that be were overthrown because iron became widespread and it made all previous technologies obsolete. And it wasn't just iron weapons either. Some have suggested that the development of iron tools for agriculture made farming easier, and the huge level of social organization that was needed to make enough food back in the Bronze Age was no longer required, making that absolutist command economy type political system of the Bronze Age pointless. And the iron working theory was a really lovely idea for a while, but sadly it turned out to just be simply untrue. Along came a woman called Jane Waldbaum, who did a survey of all of the weapons that had been dug up from this era, and she set everybody straight with the facts. She found that in the 12th century Eastern Mediterranean, you know, the time and place of the Bronze Age collapse, only 3% of weapons that had been discovered were made of iron. In the following century, she finds that iron does become more popular, starts making up about 20% of weapons, but iron doesn't overtake bronze until midway through the 10th century, over 200 years after the events that we're trying to explain. The numbers just don't add up to suggest that there was some kind of iron revolution in the 12th century BCE. In fact, they suggest that iron came in rather gradually and didn't become the main metal of use until long after the Bronze Age collapse. So, end of video, I guess. Sod it all, we're back at square one. Well, not quite, because even though Childs's theory is deeply flawed, it's not completely wrong. Even though the iron revolution that he talks about almost certainly never happened, the social revolution that went along with it might have done. Childs really drew attention to the fact that Bronze Age societies and Iron Age societies were completely different, especially in Greece. The Bronze Age Mycenaeans, like the pharaohs of Egypt and the kings of Assyria, were absolute monarchs. It was the age of great men, unquestioned leaders, figures like the Wanaks, who had control of everything in their state, including the top-down command economy that kept the country functioning. But after the Bronze Age collapse, society in Greece completely changes, to one in which local autonomy is valued above all else, to one in which merchants often operate independently of the state they come from, and one in which subsistence farming replaced the large-scale agriculture of the Bronze Age world. And this is the essence of the Bronze Age collapse, the disappearing of large centralized states and the command economies they operated. After Agamemnon and his fellow great kings disappear, there won't be another single ruler of Greece for at least 850 years, you know, until the time of Aristotle. Speaking of Aristotle, he has something to say about all of this. In his book Politics, he asserts the fairly common Greek belief that only men who own property should have the rights of citizenship, seeing as they make up the hoplite class that keeps the state safe. And by fighting for the protection of their country, they have earned their superior social position. In Mycenaean Greece, the king had been the primary war leader, and like in most of these Bronze Age states, he was at the head of a large military aristocracy. Aristotle goes on to tell us that the Greeks were once ruled by the epeus, the cavalry, in this context perhaps meaning chariots. But then the heavily armored infantrymen became the most important part of any Greek army, and as a result, the government was opened up to more people. And this, he says, is why the Greeks of his day have more constitutional governments and democracies and all of that stuff. This has happened in other places in history too. So like, take medieval Japan, for example. The samurai were absolutely vital to have if you wanted to win battles. And as a result, to keep those samurai loyal, you gave them a degree of social privilege and of social rank, and you gave them all of these extra rights that the average Japanese person didn't have. But then the Meiji Restoration happened in the 19th century, and the Japanese samurai were suddenly obsolete. You didn't need them anymore. And so they lost their social rank and their privileges, and all of that was instead transferred onto the Imperial Japanese Army and Navy. Is this what happened at the end of the Bronze Age? Well, your boy Bobby D says yes. And, well, yeah, maybe. But to get into that, we should look at the Bronze Age militaries in a little bit more detail. In 1800 BCE, an Egyptian army probably looked something like this. You got lots of spearmen and lots of archers. Both of them on foot, both of them fairly cheaply armed. A spear is just a pointy stick after all, and these one-piece Egyptian bows only have an effective range of maybe 50 meters. So it's not exactly Agincourt. However, as the 12th dynasty Egyptian pharaohs started warring with the Canaanites, two new military innovations were about to change the way that everybody did war. The first was the compound bow. It was more expensive to make and considerably harder to use than the one-piece bows the Egyptians were using beforehand, but it could fire well over twice, maybe three times as far, and with a great deal more accuracy. And the other was the chariot. The Egyptians, along with everyone else in this era, quickly realized that the chariot archer was literally unstoppable on the battlefield. You can't shoot him because he shoots further and more accurately than you do, and you can't catch him because horses. I should also point out, by the way, that at this point in history, people riding on the backs of horses isn't a thing. They haven't managed to figure that out yet. If you want to harness the speed and power of a horse, you've got to attach a chariot to the back of it. And it's in this age of the chariot that the Bronze Age world we're familiar with starts to develop around 1500 to 1250-ish BCE. This is when the Hittites built their empire. It's when the Mycenaeans take over the Minoans as being the premier power of the Aegean, and it's when the Egyptians completely abandon their isolationism. In prior times, the pharaohs had been content to basically cut their entire country off from the rest of the world and create a perfect society along the Nile River, with no intention to bother or be bothered by foreigners, thank you very much. But not in the New Kingdom. The New Kingdom Egyptians were the exact opposite. They were expansionist and imperialistic. They took these chariot armies that they developed and they conquered the Levant, warred with the Hittites, and got very involved in the affairs of continental Asia. And so you get this world developing, the one that we're now very familiar with, the world of large Bronze Age empires dominated by a chariot elite. In fact, the only parts of the world where chariots aren't basically the only way of doing war are the mountainous regions of northern Anatolia and like the Zagros Mountains and stuff. But of course, chariots are expensive. The Bible, funnily enough, gives us a little bit of an idea of how valuable a chariot might have been. King Solomon buys a chariot for 600 shekels, and then has to pay for horses to pull it, which are 150 shekels each. For comparison, the fine that you have to pay for killing a slave is 30 shekels. So a chariot, even without the horses, is worth at least 20 slaves. And that's before you even consider things like the armor, the weapons, that incredibly difficult and expensive to make compound bow, and then the additional costs like land that was dedicated solely to grass for those horses to eat, the small army of bureaucrats you'd need to keep records, look after the horses, the weapons, the armor. It's the Bronze Age, they make lists of everything. And that's before you even get to the subject of who you put in the chariot. You can't just put anyone in there and expect it to go well. Driving a team of horses at full speed is incredibly dangerous, and it takes years of practice to master. And that's before you even consider that in a battlefield situation, there are many more variables to make it more dangerous to be in a chariot. What if the land is too uneven? What if you accidentally drive too close to enemy lines and they shoot one of your horses? The other three aren't really going to be able to pull its dying body along for you to make your quick getaway, are they? And that's just the driver. You still need a warrior to make the chariot a weapon, which needs to be someone capable of pulling back the incredibly heavy compound bow and shooting it accurately whilst traveling upwards of 30 miles an hour on uneven terrain, which is insane and would require a lifetime of training to do. And why is this all relevant to the Bronze Age collapse? Well, it all has to do with how these societies adapted to accommodate a large class of chariot warriors. So generally speaking, ancient peoples raise armies in one of three ways. You get the citizen militia, the kind that's most common in classical Greek states or in Republican Rome. This is where quantity often mattered as much as quality. And usually the battle strategies of these people are quite simple. For example, in ancient Greece, all you had to do to be a part of a hoplite phalanx was buy greaves, a shield, a helmet, and a spear. In the case of Athens, the average Athenian citizen would do 2 years of a kind of national service type deal, in which they'd learn to work together as a phalanx and use all these weapons, and then they'd go back to their regular citizen lives, ready to be called up in times of war en masse. And then you get professional armies, think Imperial Rome, where the military is a career and you have upwards of 20 years to get good at it. And then you get warrior classes, like the kind that existed in the Bronze Age. This usually occurs when the weapons system being used requires years of training to master, and therefore you can't just pluck people off their farms, give them this weapon, and expect it to work. Let's go back to feudal Japan as our comparative example. Say you're a 16th century Japanese warlord. You need samurai because they're unstoppable on the battlefield. And they're unstoppable on the battlefield because they spend their entire lives training with the weapon system that they use. Thus, the warrior class develops. But, as we also see with the history of feudal Japan, there is a hazard with this. When you give one class a basic monopoly on all military violence, you need to have a way of controlling them. Otherwise, they're liable to figure out pretty quickly that it's they, not the Pharaoh or Wanax, that actually hold the power here. The Bronze Age leaders seem to have done this by controlling access to the full array of equipment that a charioteer needed to be effective. For example, in ancient Egypt, a charioteer purchased and maintained his own chariot, but the Pharaoh owned all the horses and would provide them when necessary. Whilst in Mycenaean Greece, it seems like the palace provided basically everything. Weapons, armor, horses, chariot, the whole shebang. In Ugarit, there seems to have been a system which would be familiar to anyone who knows how feudalism worked, in which the king provided lands and livelihood to a hereditary charioteer class, who in return for this privilege slash responsibility owed him complete loyalty. And I really want to reaffirm that the chariot was king at this point. Even relatively small city-states like Pylos could field upwards of 500 charioteers, and the big states and empires have fucking loads of them. At the Battle of Kadesh, for example, the Hittite king is said to have fielded 3,500 heavy chariots. The Battle of Kadesh, by the way, is an epic one, and one where the charioteers play a central role. It's worth going into in detail, but we don't really have time in this video, so there are some links in the description to other videos which go into it, you know, with more depth. But the Battle of Kadesh was also one of the last great chariot battles. After it happens, in the late 13th century BCE, the Near East enjoys a period of unprecedented peace, often referred to as the Pax Mycenaea. Now, it's not that all warfare came to an end, but the big wars between the great states and empires, you know, the kind where they would mobilize these huge chariot armies, did come to an end for a little bit, which was, I'm sure, a relief to everyone at the time. But this also put an end to innovation, which turned out to be a little bit of a bad thing, because when the collapse begins, the charioteers were meant to be the shield that guarded the realms of men against the sea peoples or whatever violent force was coming their way, and clearly they failed. And new technologies rose up to take the place of the chariot. Not iron, as people had once thought, but horses and new weapons. Starting with horses, directly after the collapse, the chariot starts to give way to the mounted cavalryman as being the fastest thing on the battlefield. Us human beings had finally gotten to that point in our history where we bred horses large enough to carry a person by themselves. Although on the surface level, the cavalryman seems like the obvious successor to the chariot, there are some key differences. They are cheaper, easier to maintain, and considerably harder to control. You know when I said that with chariots, the king could maintain control because there were so many moving parts to a chariot, all he had to do was maintain a monopoly on one of those, and he'd hamstring the whole affair. Well, that's not the case with the cavalryman. It's just the one horse he needs. And not to mention that, but just one horse is considerably cheaper than four horses and a chariot, and easier to learn how to do, which means a much greater number of people can now basically dominate the battlefield with speed. And it's incredibly evident that cavalry instantly changed the way that battles were fought. For example, in the Old Testament, the Israelite King Saul is slain on Mount Gilboa by the Philistine Parashim, which means horses or horsemen. Clearly, it was with cavalry that battles would now be decided. But neither the cavalry nor the chariots were as important as infantry in the post-collapse world. In the Bronze Age, having large numbers of infantry was usually more trouble than it was worth. As we've already discussed, the chariots decided the battle. So having a large number of foot soldiers was just a burden. How were you going to feed them? However, we see this start to really change after the collapse, especially in Greece, where artwork of warriors starts to depict far more of them fighting hand to hand on foot. Even the Egyptians, who loved the chariot more than most, start to rely more and more on infantry. Back in the days of Ramses the Great, any noble Egyptian would always fight with a bow in a chariot, supported by some infantry, but not many. Even when times got desperate and the Egyptians introduced a kind of form of conscription, it wasn't total conscription, it was at most 1 in 10 of one particular class of Egyptian man. But a century later, in the reign of Ramses III, the pharaoh is portrayed as both a chariot warrior and a foot warrior, and his soldiers seem to be largely infantry. I think there are some nice metaphors for this change in the Iliad. For those of you that don't know, the Iliad is an epic poem by the Greek poet Homer, and it's set during the Trojan War, a semi-mythical war that took place towards the end of the Bronze Age. Now, the poem itself was written down well into the Iron Age, although it maintains its Bronze Age setting, so I'm not suggesting we take it at face value, but regardless, I think there are some useful hints as to how things were changing in bits of the poem. To start with, there's the character of Nestor. Nestor is the king of the Mycenaean city of Pylos, and he's also fucking ancient. He's like 90 years old at this point. He's been the veteran of many, many campaigns and stories. He went and adventured with Jason and the Argonauts, and you know, I'm getting carried away. Point is, Nestor is the oldest of the Achaeans, and he fights in the old way, from his chariot. The new kids, the young ones like Achilles and Diomedes, they fight on foot as infantrymen. They have chariots, but they really only use them as taxis to get to and from the battlefield. In Book 4 of the Iliad, Nestor gives a speech to his men in which he encourages them to stay in their chariots in battle, saying, "When a man from his own car encounters the enemy chariots, let him stab with his spear, since this is the stronger fighting. So, men before your time sacked tower and city, keeping a spirit like this in their hearts, and like this their purpose." It's curious, isn't it, that old man Nestor still wants to fight from his chariot, whilst the younger warriors have abandoned it in favor of fighting on foot. Maybe it suggests that the younger generation of Achaeans considered the chariot obsolete, and Nestor's kind of a relic of a bygone age. And then there's one of the most dramatic bits of the poem, when Achilles, filled with wrath and rage at the death of his beloved Patroclus, kills Hector, the prince of Troy. Now, quick thing to point out, in the Iliad, pretty much every major character has an epithet, which is like a little description that goes along with them. There are 20 million characters in the Iliad, so you kind of need the epithets to remember who's who and what their main character trait is. Wily and cunning Odysseus, for example. Grey-eyed Athena. White-armed Hera. Well, the most common epithet that Homer gives Achilles, and the one that he's given when he kills Hector, is swift-footed Achilles. Hector, on the other hand, is usually called tamer of horses. The last line of the poem is famously, "And so they buried Hector, tamer of horses." What does this mean? Possibly not much. It could just be cool-sounding things to say before the name of your hero. Or maybe there's some hidden meaning that I don't understand because I'm not a 3,000-year-old Greek. But I think it's significant when we consider that the poem is set in a time when chariot warriors are being replaced by foot soldiers and centralized monarchies are being replaced by decentralized aristocratic governments. Take Achilles as a character, for example. Achilles is certainly special. His mum's a goddess, he's an incredible warrior, and he leads the Myrmidons. But he's not a king. Central to the story is that he doesn't lead the Achaeans. Agamemnon leads the Achaeans. But Agamemnon doesn't have full control over Achilles either. That's also very central to the story, that Achilles can kind of pick and choose which days he wants to fight on based on his mood. Hector is completely different. He is a prince of Troy, next in line for the throne. A true representative of the old world. Could it be that Achilles represents this new type of soldier that Drews talks about? Fights on foot, less wealthy than his charioteer counterparts, but fully understanding that real power lies with his sword arm and not with his king? And could it be that Hector, tamer of horses, represents the old monarchies, dependent on chariots, the ones that were dying out in this Bronze Age collapse because they could not withstand the new fighting style of men like Achilles? But that's just a bit of literary interpretation. Like I said, I'm not a 3,000-year-old Greek man, and I haven't yet met one who I can ask, so I don't know for sure what Homer means by all of this. So let's get back to the actual physical evidence that we have. the archaeological discoveries of weapons and armor from the 12th century BCE that might testify to this change in the way that war was conducted. Well, one of the big things that clearly becomes popular during the collapse and just afterwards is the use of swords by infantrymen. Swords weren't really a big thing in the Bronze Age world. They had spears, they had axes, they had bows, but swords, not so much. Sure, you get the Egyptian sickle sword, which looks metal as fuck, but practically speaking, not that useful for much more than cutting the penises of your dead enemies. But around the year 1200, which coincidentally is the year that the collapse begins, this rather fancy looking bit of gear here becomes widely used. It's one that we also see in our depictions of the Sea People. And, well, just read book 5 of the Iliad to learn what a skilled warrior can do with a decent sword. Back to the Iliad quickly. The other epithet that's used very commonly to describe the Achaeans as opposed to the Trojans is well-greaved. And what do you know, surprise, surprise, greaves start being used in this era. Now, in Bronze Age warfare, greaves aren't that useful. If you're fighting from a chariot or against an enemy who largely has bows and arrows, they're added protection, but you know, not really. They're not going to be your major concern. You know where greaves are useful? In a big shield wall, where your legs are really the most vulnerable bit of you other than maybe your face and neck. When it comes to classical greaves, if you're in a hoplite phalanx, greaves are an absolute must-have tool. So the sudden appearance of lots of greaves certainly suggests that the new way of fighting was as a mass of infantry, because suddenly you have to protect your little legs dangling out from underneath your shield. And all of this evidence points to the core of Robert Druse's theory, that the Bronze Age world had been one dominated by charioteers, and that the societies they'd created had been built around maintaining this chariot class, and when the chariot became obsolete, the lower classes slash sea people slash outside forces could easily pick apart the now severely weakened Bronze Age world. And younger me was incredibly impressed by this theory. It was kind of like if we discovered that fridge magnets could disable missiles and tanks. The powers that be would be powerless to stop regular people from simply overrunning them. But the theory is incomplete. Say, if we modern people did suddenly develop the ability to neutralize high-grade military gear with our fridge magnets, does that mean we would? I mean, if things were going well, we probably wouldn't, right? And this leads us back to the same question that we had to ask of the Sea Peoples, which is, why now? Why was it that around 1200 BCE, the Bronze Age world suddenly turned itself inside out? But there needs to be a root cause of the violence. We have to remember that this book was written back in 1993, and a great deal of what we know about the Bronze Age now wasn't known to Robert Druse back then. Not to mention, coming right out of the 1980s, whenever you brought up the Bronze Age collapse, the usual response that you'd get from more or less anyone was usually centered around the argument of the Sea Peoples. And Druse's work is a clear response to that academic trend. And Druse himself admits this, that the picture he paints is based on some really wild assumptions and guesswork. But to be fair to him, so is more or less anything you say about this era, because as I've said many times in the last 3 videos, evidence is so, so scant. But to complete the picture, we need to go beyond the question of how violence changed and get to the root of why there was violence. And the answer to that may lie in discoveries made since 1993. Discoveries that we'll get into in more detail in the next video. Thanks for watching.
No trustworthy oaths between men and lions, nor wolves and lambs have spirit that can be brought to agreement, but forever hold these feelings of hate for each other, and there can be no love between you and me. And as a star moves among stars in the night's darkening, Hesper, who is the fairest star who stands in the sky, such was the shining from the pointed spear Achilles was shaking in his right hand, with evil intention towards brilliant Hector.
What's with all the candles?
It's called ambiance, bro. Have you never fucking heard? No, don't switch the fucking light up. I mean, to be fair, it was difficult to read in the dark anyway.